Hey everyone, welcome to Get Ready With Me and Talk About Stuff. I am your host, Stephanie. Welcome. This is the show in which I talk to you about whatever is on my mind and I put on my makeup at the same time. The subjects I cover are anywhere from silly to serious to anything in between or above. It could be, you just never know what you're going to get when you come here. But it's a fun show and I hope you'll stick around and just hang out with me for a while. If you're new here, welcome. This is not a makeup tutorial. I'm not going to be talking about what I'm doing. I'm just going to be doing it. So if you're looking for a tutorial, there are plenty of them out there, but this is not one. And if you've been enjoying the show, please subscribe to the channel. That helps me out tremendously. And if you think there are other people who might enjoy the videos, please share. I love to have more people coming here to hang out with me. Makes for a good time. So today's subject is going to be, it's going to be one that you're either going to love or hate. I don't think there's going to be much in between. We're going to delve into, you know, American history is complicated. It just is. And I thought for President's Day, what could be more fun than talking about Abraham Lincoln, correct? Well, we'll see. Anyway, so this episode is going to be about Nance Legins-Costley, Abraham Lincoln, how their roads intersected, and the complicated legacy that Abraham Lincoln left behind. Are you ready? Let's dive in. So Nance Legins-Costley was an enslaved woman who was born in 1813. She lived in Illinois, but I believe she spent her early life in Maryland. But her story becomes especially significant when she is 15 years old and she is, you know, an attempt is made to sell her to another slaver. And she basically says no. And that's kind of where we're going to pick up her story. Now, Illinois was a free state. But there were all sorts of, you know, to the shock of everyone I know, there were all sorts of loopholes that a person could use to kind of get around the free state status. So while Illinois was a free state, basically it allowed for slavery by another name. Indentured servitude, or, you know, people could come from slave states with those they had enslaved and be granted, like, I get permission, I guess, for lack of a better term, to keep them on in their enslaved status. So even though Illinois was a free state, there were all sorts of maneuvers people could do to continue enslaving people and just call it something else. Not unlike a lot of things that still happen today. But Nance Legins was enslaved in Illinois. And at the age of 15, she was sold. And she decided that she was not having it. She was going to fight for her freedom. And she did. Nance Legins-Costley began her fight for freedom at the young age of 15, and she would go on to appear before the Supreme Court 3 times. Now, the first 2 times, as you might guess, she, obviously, as you might guess, it's a real big mystery what happened. She was not granted her freedom. It was basically said, you know, she had no rights. She could, you know, she did not possess the same rights as white people, and she could be bought and sold at the whim of whoever enslaved her. She did not give up, though. She continued fighting, and she would eventually be granted her freedom. She would be emancipated in 1842. Her attorney, for her third appearance before the Supreme Court, was none other than Abraham Lincoln. He helped secure the freedom of Nance Legins-Costley 20 years before the Civil War. Nance Legins-Costley went on to live a very full and, from what I'm reading, a very, you know, a very fulfilling life as a free woman. And her freedom not only was for herself, but it was for all of her children. None of her children could be coerced into indentured servitude or enslaved under the guise of indentured servitude ever. So her fight was not only for herself, but also for her children. She had 8 children with her husband, Ben Costley. Her oldest son, William, would be one of the original Buffalo soldiers. He would eventually become a disabled veteran, but not before being present and part of, being present for and part of the first ever Juneteenth celebration. And I will leave a link in the description if you're not sure what Juneteenth is. I will leave a link so you can do some investigating yourself. And then her husband passed away in 1882, I believe. Hold on, as per usual, I will have to consult my notes. Her husband Ben died. She ended up moving in with her daughter, who lived in Peoria, Illinois, and then she would pass away in 1893. She would be buried in, and this is what caught my, this is the little tidbit of information that first caught my attention, that she was buried in what is now a defunct grave, or a defunct cemetery, the Moffett Cemetery, and has actually been paved over, and it's part of like, it's part of an industrial complex now. When I first was introduced to her story, that was what caught my attention, because it was like, well, what? This woman who, she was a trailblazer in a very real sense, and it's possible that, you know, her grave was paved over. That's just terrible. That is horrible. And it's not just her, but really anybody. I mean, supposedly the bodies were moved, but even the city historians have said that it's likely there were some bodies that didn't get moved and were in fact, their graves were in fact paved over, which is just terrible. I don't know why these things happen, but they do. And that was what caught my attention. Like, this is awful. This is like a terrible injustice to these people. But, it, you know, I got to learn about her. And I got to learn that 20 years before there was ever a Civil War, Abraham Lincoln was working to secure freedom for a black family in Illinois. Now, Abraham Lincoln's legacy is very complicated. I keep applying concealer, by the way, because my face is very red. I've not been feeling well. I'm not just doing repetitive things for no good reason. I've not been feeling well, and my face is so blotchy. Anyway, so Abraham Lincoln's legacy regarding race is a complicated one, and I think it's dishonest to say otherwise. Even though Abraham Lincoln fought, rightfully so, for the freedom of Nance Legins-Costley and her family, he still held some extraordinarily racist ideas. And I know that there are people out there, and there are a lot of them, who would argue that, you know, his being the, eventually becoming the great emancipator, it almost makes up for the fact that he held these ideas. And he didn't just hold them and release them, you know, during the Civil War. It's not like all of a sudden he just became not racist. These were ideas that he carried through his life. And I think even within himself, his own understanding of race and where he drew the line, I guess, between the way he saw people of color, particularly black people, as people, and then where he also saw them as people but less than him. I think even within himself, that was a complex issue from what I've read of him. However, his words are still with us. We can look back at his legacy, you know, his, sorry, not his legacy, but his words over his career in politics. And we can see that while he did indeed fight for the freedom of enslaved people and had done so for most of his career. He held some very toxic ideas about black people that unfortunately were also ideas held by people who would go on to cause untold misery for the black community long after slavery had ended. So I think it's important to discuss that. I'm going to read to you a couple of quotes. The first one is from 1858 during a debate with Stephen Douglas, who was probably his most formidable political foe. And in this debate, the assertion had been made at the time that he was too friendly to the black community. He was too much a friend of the black community. And then, as often happens now, there was concern that building a bridge there would significantly alter the way of life for white people. And we can say all we want that this is a thing of the past, but if we're being honest, we know it's not. But anyway, this is what he had to say. I will say then that I am not, nor ever have been, in favor of bringing about in any way the social and political equality of the white and black races. And then there was applause. That I am not, nor have ever been, in favor of making voters or jurors of Negroes, nor of qualifying them to hold office, nor to intermarry with white people. And I will say, in addition to this, that there is a physical difference between the white and black races, which I believe will forever forbid the two races living together on terms of social and political equality. And inasmuch as they cannot so live, while they do remain together, there must be the position of superior and inferior. And I, as much as any other man, am in favor of having the superior position assigned to the white race. That was from September 15th, 1858. He went on in 1862 to say this. And this was to a black audience. You and we are different races. We have between us a broader distance than exists between almost any other two races. Whether it is right or wrong, I need not discuss, but this physical difference is a great disadvantage to us both, as I think. Your race suffer very greatly, many of them by living among us, while ours suffer from your presence. In a word, we suffer on each side. Those are racist ideas. The common answer that is given when mention of Abraham Lincoln's racist ideas comes to the forefront is that he was progressive for his time. And that may well be said. I do think that for his time, Abraham Lincoln was progressive. I mean, there were many abolitionists out there, but Abraham Lincoln was able to exercise his desire for abolition from a seat of tremendous power. However, it is also worth noting that Abraham Lincoln did not have a problem with individual slavers. He never would have, had it not been for the Civil War, it was not his desire in any way whatsoever to forbid existing slavers from enslaving people. That was not his wish whatsoever. If, you know, his desire was to prevent any new states from having slavery as part of their as part of establishing their state. He did not want new states to be slave states. That was where he stood on the issue. But as far as individual slavers who were already slavers and anybody who was already enslaved, he once said that it was his desire, if people were going to be free, you know, if the enslaved people were going to go free, that Sure, they can, but let's send them all back to Africa. So he had a very strong idea, a very strong set of ideals, I should say, about the differences between the white and black race and what should be done with enslaved people who are set free. And it was never his desire to have enslaved people living among white people as equals. And it's important, I think, to be honest about that, because as much as we celebrate his legacy, I think the reason it's important to be honest about these things is because we have to acknowledge that for a good number of people who call this country home, this country has never at any time felt fully free or safe. Opportunities have never felt equal. They have never felt like this country was theirs too. And I think part of moving toward the direction that the country seems to want to go, which is one that is progressive, more inclusive, really becoming the country that we all like to imagine we already are when we see atrocities happening, and we like to say, this is not who we are. If we could become the country we like to imagine we are when we're saying those things, I think we have to be honest about how we got where we are. Was it Abraham Lincoln's job to fix everyone's attitudes about black people? Well, no. I mean, that's not anybody's job. You know, that's not something anybody is really capable of doing. I mean, you know, you can't take hundreds of years of racist notions and just legislate them away. And that's true. That's as true today as it was yesterday, as it was 100 years ago, as it was 200 years ago. However, the way we talk about these things does matter. The bottom line is, as far as Abraham Lincoln, by not challenging the ideas that led people to believe that enslaving people in the first place was okay because it was a superior race enslaving an inferior race, by not challenging that, he, whether he intended to or not, reinforced ideas that after slavery was abolished in the United States, the ideas that one race is superior to another, that there are too many differences between the black race and the white race to coexist peacefully together, to intermarry and so forth, those ideas, they still cause problems today. And it's only been within fairly recent history that steps have been taken to try to make to make society a more equitable place with equal access to opportunities, equal access to an education, equal access to marry who you love, regardless of their race. That's all fairly recent. That's all fairly recent history. And these are things that stemmed from the idea that black people and white people are too different to coexist on equal footing, and there is indeed a superior race. And unfortunately, intentionally or not, the words that Abraham Lincoln used during his lifetime when discussing the races and discussing emancipation and abolition and so forth only served to undergird those opinions. I mean, think about if you have, you know, if the president of the United States, well, we've had this in our own recent history, when the president of the United States has a history of saying terribly racist things, the most vile racists among us latch on to those words, and even the racists that think they're actually one of the good guys will latch on to those words and use them to validate their own racist opinions, and furthermore, will use them to validate lobbying for racist legislation. So, Abraham Lincoln's legacy is complicated. One thing I see people do a lot when discussing him is assert that because of the Emancipation Proclamation, we have to sort of overlook everything else because he showed us who he was when he signed the Emancipation Proclamation. The reality of that is, if he could have ended the war without doing that, he would have, and he said so himself. Also true is that a person can hold terrible, terrible ideas and still do very good things. I'm going to use a couple of modern examples. They don't reach anywhere near the magnitude of what Abraham Lincoln achieved with the Emancipation Proclamation, but it does sort of set the sorry, I'm having a day here. It does sort of put a fine point on what people are willing to overlook when one of their, you know, their perceptions about someone they consider a hero is challenged. So in modern day, I can think of a couple of people who, you know, in my recent conversations on Twitter and other social media, people have jumped in to defend these people, saying that because they did good things that we need to overlook the bad. One of them is Dave Ramsey. Dave Ramsey, as you may know, he's considered like a financial guru by a lot of people, particularly, you guessed it, white evangelical Christians. Dave Ramsey is also known to be homophobic. He is also known to be sexist. He is known to be menacing and threatening to his employees. He has completely disregarded the severity of the COVID pandemic and, you know, therefore putting his employees at risk. And so on and so on. There is a lot that could be said about Dave Ramsey. He also has a long track record of talking down to poor people and not bothering to understand what actually puts people in poverty, and instead blaming someone for their situation regardless of what else is going on in their life. And I've seen this in videos, I've seen this in his words. There is a strong resistance on his part to understand that not everyone has access to the volume of income he says that they need in order to do what he says they need to do to get out of debt. When I mentioned that Dave Ramsey has made a lot of money by talking down to poor people, he's made an obscene amount of money doing it, in fact, there were a lot of people who jumped in and said, but his methods work. I don't care. I really don't care. I don't think that we need to overlook the wrong someone does just because they also do some things right. And I think that is where I stand with Abraham Lincoln's legacy. Yes, he did do some good things. He did some amazing things. But he also held ideas that would perpetuate long into the future after the Emancipation Proclamation that actively harmed people, that still harm people today. Now, is that entirely his fault? Well, no, but it is our fault if we don't speak honestly about Abraham Lincoln and anyone we might consider a hero. We have to at least acknowledge that he was flawed. And we have to acknowledge that by not directly condemning the attitudes that allowed people to so thoughtlessly enslave people in the first place, he helped perpetuate that. I don't believe he did that intentionally, but I do believe that he did that. He and so many others. I don't think that Abraham Lincoln alone is to blame for that. But when you hold a position of power, your words matter. And choosing to say that he did not believe that the white race and the black race were equals, that there was indeed a superior race, by choosing to perpetuate that narrative in his speeches and in his debates, he contributed to suffering that has now gone on for, you know, hundreds of years. Since before America was even a country, there has been justification after justification for causing people to suffer because of their race. And whether he intended to do it or not, he contributed to that. There were a few things that happened during his administration that really, it gave him the opportunity to set a new standard. And he kind of, in my opinion, did it by half measures. Now, I know there are a lot of people who are going to disagree with me. I know that. But keep in mind a couple of things. The Emancipation Proclamation did not free every enslaved person. It freed every enslaved person in the South. Okay? Let's get that straight right now. So that was a half measure in itself. If he was going to enslave, or if he was going to emancipate enslaved people, why not just do it across the board? Secondly, during his administration, during the Civil War, in the state of Minnesota, there was what has come to be called the Minnesota Uprising. Now, the Minnesota Uprising was an uprising of the Lakota, at the time referred to as the Sioux tribe, in response to essentially being starved. Provisions, because the Civil War was happening, provisions and so forth were not being shipped out in a timely manner. And the Lakota, who had been forced onto a reservation that they could not cultivate because the land was basically garbage, they couldn't grow anything there, they had nothing. They were starving. And it got to the point where at least one Indian agent recognized the problem and tried to negotiate with the people who had like general goods stores and so forth as part of the Indian agency. They tried to work with them to get them to release some provisions to the indigenous people on credit, and then they would just be reimbursed when the shipments and the money finally arrived. And one of them is famous for his response, which I will now read to you. At least I think I will. Maybe, if I can find it. Okay. So, the store owner, he was a trader actually, as in he traded goods. Andrew Myrick is known for saying, and he had two stores opened at the Indian agencies. And he said, "So far as I'm concerned, if they are hungry, let them eat grass or their own dung." And this was the attitude that the indigenous people of Minnesota were up against. It became very clear that there were more people who were willing to let them starve to death than there are who would be willing to help them weather these delays in provisions and help them get through these difficult times. So the response to that, after their needs were going unmet and people were starving, literally starving, and it was clear that nothing was going to be done, there was an uprising. And Andrew Myrick would actually die. He died on August 18th, 1862. A battle of the Lower Sioux Agency, led by Chief Little Crow, in revenge for the agency refusing to give them food. He was killed that day, and his body was found days later with his, he had been decapitated, and his mouth had been stuffed full of grass. I'm having a hard time finding sympathy for the eye. Now, in response to that, a military tribunal found 300 of the indigenous people guilty of these crimes, and they were sentenced to be hanged. Abraham Lincoln commuted the sentences of all but 38 of them, and or all but 39. So 39 were scheduled to be hanged. The day before the hanging, which would have been Christmas Day, another person was, I don't know if their sentence was commuted or what it was, but I'm thinking it was a male, but they were not hanged. On December 26th, however, 38 Lakota or Sioux were hanged in public. It was meant to serve as possibly a warning of sorts. It was meant to, punish them for having the sheer gall to suggest that they shouldn't be starved to death, and then retaliating against people who said, well, yes, you should. You know, now some have said, and this may be true, that in commuting the sentences the way he did, Abraham Lincoln was acknowledging that the reason there was an uprising was because of abuse by the Indian agents. And that's great. However, to my knowledge, none of the Indian agents who were involved in essentially orchestrating the elimination via starvation of these people were ever really held accountable for what they did. So that, again, returns us to the complicated question of not just Abraham Lincoln, but of anyone that we call a hero. In the evangelical world right now, there is a lot of controversy surrounding a man named Revi Zacharias, who has, it's coming to light more and more, he had a long history of abusing women, of using his position as a person with influence and power to have inappropriate relationships with women and use that position to abuse people, abuse women. Now, there are people, as this story unfolds, who are taking deep offense to the notion that Revi Zacharias was not a good person. In fact, he was kind of, a very terrible person. And whenever it's suggested that he actually did these things, people are jumping in to excuse them because, well, maybe he did do those things, but look at all the good things he did. So my question for all of us is, at what point do we have to say the good does not outweigh the bad that these people helped perpetuate? And I think that's a serious question, especially in light of complicated legacies like Abraham Lincoln's. His racist ideas do have to coexist with the work that he did because they are all part of the same person. And I think that whitewashing all of this and making it palatable is a disservice to people of color who are still living with the ideas and the attitudes that he helped perpetuate in his speeches and in his debates. Certainly, he's not the only one. But my point is, we can't elevate him as being above his own words. We can't elevate him as a hero while also ignoring that he did things that contributed to a lot of harm not just in my brain is so foggy right now. Not just in the immediate future following when he said these things, but still today. So I think as we celebrate him, we also have to be very honest about what his legacy is, because it is not as cut and dry as being, quote, the great emancipator. He was also someone who held very racist ideas, was very vocal about those racist ideas, and you can bet there are people out there to this day who latch on to his quotes as a justification for holding the views that they do regarding Black people and other people of color. All right, I'm going to finish this up because I really don't even know what I'm doing. I'm just kind of throwing makeup on my eyes and just like, oh, yeah, that looks okay. I don't know what I'm doing. So I'm going to go finish this off camera, and then I'll come back with some final thoughts. All right, I'm back. I tried lashes again because I haven't been doing them lately. As per usual, one of them looks semi-okay. The other one looks like it wants to run away from my eye. Anyway, so why did I want to talk about this today? Obviously, it's President's Day, but I also think anytime it's important that we recall history in its accuracy. Because I do think, especially with this issue of, you know, can people be racist and still do very good things? I think that, you know, this is something that we need to have a conversation about, because I think it's very easy to dismiss racist ideas if the person who holds them is doing decent things. I think this is something that white people have done for a very long time. We've tolerated a lot of, racist ideas from relatives, from elected officials, from, you know, anybody in our lives who we deem important enough, we will overlook a lot of things, a lot of really harmful things, because they've done some good things. And I think that that has only served to perpetuate problems. And it really isn't helpful for anyone for us to do that. So I think as we recall Abraham Lincoln and his legacy, it is possible to say he did a very good thing while also holding some very racist and harmful ideas which helped perpetuate a lot of harm in the years to come. If you were to, you know, I've seen several indigenous people comment on the hangings that took place in Minnesota, and that's not something I ever learned about until just a few years ago, because it's just not discussed in the history that I learned in school. And that's just one example of the way we receive history has been very whitewashed. And it matters. Even as I was researching Nance Legins-Costley, one of the videos that I watched was made by the author of a book about her, and he did not refer to her as an enslaved person. He referred to her as a slave. He did not call her slaver. He called her her owner, or called him her owner. Those things matter, because the way we discuss these things impacts the way we deal with, you know, the long-term consequences of the ideas that were held that allowed slavery to happen in the first place. And that's where I am with Abraham Lincoln. I don't think that, you know, am I going to call him a completely terrible person and try to cancel him because he had these ideas? Well, no. But I do think it's important, not just about him, but, you know, anybody that we consider a hero, or some consider a hero, it's important to be honest about who they were. It is possible to hold incredibly toxic ideas and still do good things. That does not negate the toxic ideas you hold, though, or the impact those ideas have on people down the road. So it's, you know, I challenge my fellow white people to be honest in our discussion of history, and to understand that we were given an extraordinarily whitewashed version of the history of the United States. And that if we were to peel back the layers of the whitewashing and really examine where we've been and where we are, there is an understanding that this country has not always been free for everyone who calls it home. And the only way we can move forward into a place where there is true equity, true freedom, true equality, is to understand that these things, these ugly things, are as much a part of the makeup of the United States as the good things that we all like to talk about. And we can't really move forward with integrity and have true peace until we take an honest assessment of the country that we are, how we got where we are, and make amends where we can. And I think part of doing justice to history is telling the whole story, not just the parts that sound good. So anyway, I'm sure everybody's got opinions about this. I welcome them. Please be respectful in the comments. I'm happy to discuss things with anybody who approaches me respectfully. Whether you agree with me or not, that's fine. Just please be respectful. I hope you have a great rest of your day, and be good to yourselves, be good to each other, don't shit on yourselves or anyone else. Please remember, we are still in a pandemic, so practice the necessary precautions to keep yourself and your family safe, and I will talk with you again very soon. Bye!